body of the latest hero in Portuguese history is brought back to the Lisbon barracks where he was killed last week, the only death in an attempted right-wing coup. The coup itself was a miserable failure. It succeeded only in driving Portugal even further to the left. Portuguese people were quick to pay tribute to the unlikely hero, Private Carvalho Luís, the army's first casualty in 11 months of the revolution which put an end to 50 years of right-wing dictatorship. Throughout, the red carnation has been the symbol of the armed forces movement, the MFA. The people and the army express their solidarity in flowers. For nearly a year, aware that the right wing might try to regain control, the armed forces have remained on the alert, led by COPCON, the elite security force. But when the right wing coup came, it was pathetically inadequate. Two antique training aircraft shot up the barracks of a left wing artillery regiment, and helicopters landed a handful of paratroops to take control. Within a few hours, they had withdrawn in confusion. The casualties, 18 wounded, an officer's Volkswagen rocketed, Private Luis dead. The failed revolt shattered the right of center parties in Portugal. Their hero, former President Spínola, fled to South America discredited. Left-wing officers in the MFA have used the coup to strengthen their position, to the dismay of moderate political leaders, suspicious that events work constantly to the benefit of the communists.
This coup, in my opinion, is a very stupid thing, with no sense. And I think that, once again, General Spínola rendered a very bad service to the country because he allowed some parties, such as the Communist Party, to take enormous political credits of a totally small and idiot thing that had no possibility of success. And even if it had, it was against, I think, it was against the democratic principles that he himself accepted when he accepted being President of the Republic in April.
Alvaro Cunhal, government minister and Communist Party leader, was not surprised by the attempted coup.
Semana passada.
Naturalmente, esperávamos golpe de Estado, não podíamos dizer se era a semana passada, mas certamente o esperávamos. Havia toda uma preparação política para esse golpe e havia uma conspiração de que se conheciam numerosos indícios. Portanto, era previsível, estava previsto, a data não se sabia.
It was perfectly everybody was expecting actually a coup d'état because there was a political conspiracy in that respect, but of course it was completely impossible to foresee the date.
Has the country benefited or lost anything from the failure of the coup?
O país beneficia sempre de uma derrota da reação. Trata-se mais uma derrota da reação, naturalmente que o país beneficiou e beneficiará sempre que a reação tente avançar contra a democracia e que seja derrotada como sucedeu no 11 de março.
Dr. Cunha says it was obviously beneficial because any kind of coup d'etat which comes from the reaction being
put down
is actually to be interpreted as a victory.
Victory.
Beneficial to the country, I would say.
Although the date was unforeseeable, the left was well prepared. When the move came, random military checkpoints appeared within hours. On potential escape routes to Spain, self-appointed vigilante patrols, often with Communist Party armbands, mounted roadblocks, although the border remained officially open. Wanted lists of names and car numbers were immediately circulated. In Lisbon itself, new posters suddenly appeared, proclaiming that Portugal's 14 banks were now the property of the people. Many staff and all customers queued on the pavement and the doors remained closed. In Inside, on the afternoon of the coup, bankers found themselves arrested by armed members of their own staff. Eight men in one banking family were lined against a wall by a civilian with a machine gun. A uniformed officer intervened to save them. It wasn't until 3 days later that the government formally announced nationalization of the banks. The news spread in the normal way through leaflets, announcing that compensation for anyone holding stock worth £10,000 or more would be nil. The bankers themselves were hustled into Portugal's most notorious jail at Caxias outside Lisbon, 12 to a cell. There they found themselves alongside the secret police agents who had been arrested during last April's revolution. Though the bankers were not ill-treated and some have now been freed, the operation bore all the marks of a left-wing witch hunt. The crime was being a capitalist.
Quem pode ter receio do Partido Comunista Português? Quem tenha receio de perder privilégios injustos? Mais ninguém.
Who could ever fear the Communist Party? Whoever could fear to lose any kind of privileges?
Injustos.
Unfair privileges.
Quer dizer, quem tenha receio de perder privilégios, situações de abuso, é que pode receber.
Only who fears to lose privileges and favors can in any way feel fear of the political party. Of the Communist Party.
So you agree with the bankers being put in Caxias?
Os banqueiros certamente não estarão muito contentes com o Partido Comunista.
For sure that the bankers cannot be very happy with the Communist Party.
Mas o nosso povo não estava contente com os banqueiros.
But our people, the Portuguese people, was not happy with the bankers.
Mas a ligação entre banqueiros e reação é visível.
But the connection between bankers and reaction is obvious.
Alguns banqueiros, digamos.
Some bankers.
Os banqueiros jogaram no regresso ao passado fascista.
The bankers wanted and were
jogaram.
Jogaram. They played on
no regresso ao passado
on the return from the fascists.
Perderam a parada.
They lost the play.
Pagam o preço.
Are you
they
saying
have to pay a price for it?
The Armed Forces Movement spokesman justifies the arrests.
There are a number of people who have been put in prison since March the 11th.
Yes,
how many are there?
About 100.
And who are they?
Military people and also civil people related to the banks.
How many of those are civilians?
It's about 50-50. I would say 50 military men and 50 civil.
And is the accusation that the civilians were involved in the coup?
Yes, they were involved in the sense as economy boycott and sending millions of contos abroad and financing suspect parties involved in this coup.
Do you think that there is still a position for political moderate people? Are their voices being heard?
You talk about moderate people, but moderate it's a very ambiguous word. If you mean by moderate a reactionary one, of course it is not allowed.
No, I don't mean reactionary.
If you mean for moderate, let us say people.
I mean social democrats, for instance.
Yes, of course they will have a voice.
But raising that voice, as Portugal prepares for its first free elections for 50 years, becomes daily more risky for parties between the two extremes. Four people died in a riot after a recent rally for the PPD, the Social Democrats. The headquarters of the Conservatives, the CDS, were ransacked after the attempted coup. They fear that a minority Communist Party will simply seize power, as in Czechoslovakia in 1948.
we have about 20 headquarters destroyed in the country last week because of the attacks by extreme left-wing groups. And these events can lead to a chaos in Portuguese affairs or to a left-wing dictatorship if things are not well kept in the hands of the authority of the state.
How strong is that possibility?
I say it will depend on our own existence of as a party. If we are banned, I would say that Czechoslovakia is established in Portugal. If we exist as a party, and if we are allowed to dispute elections and to have free opportunities of campaigning and going to the electoral day in a calm, peaceful atmosphere, then the dangers won't exist. But in the contrary, if we are banned, if we are not authorized to keep our political activities, I assure you that Czechoslovakia is in Portugal.
And
this is my point. Then that democracy, I hope this won't happen, but democracy cannot be built in Portugal against my party or without my party. This is definitive.
What is the position of the CDS? Will they be banned?
Yeah, well, it depends. It depends on the way they will admit to concur to the elections, but I don't think they will be banned as you have suggested.
And there is no question of the PPD being banned either.
Yes, of course, PPD belongs to the government. Is within the government at this moment, and there is no intention of disbanding the PPD at the moment. Not only at the moment. Belongs to the government.
Being in the government hasn't protected the PPD against direct intimidation.
I look back in the mirror of my car every time I drive alone. In some cases, I have been driving with another car of our own people following me. Because, especially in those moments, as I was telling you, of crisis, then things go down. I have to change. As you know, I had my car. I had a bomb under my car, so plastered, and I had to buy a new car. I changed home recently because of having more security conditions in there.
You had to move house?
Yes.
Do you feel safe enough to sleep in your own home every night?
Yes, although sometimes we have already taken precautions of not sleeping home, but that's on very special occasions.
Are you offered any sort of protection at all?
No.
Formal protection?
No. It was asked to the government, in my special case, because after the bombing by my party, but until now we had no answer.
You asked for protection and
yes,
weren't...
Yes, my party officially asked for protection for me, personally, because of the bombing. After that, everybody was very thrilled with the bomb.
And what happened as a result of your request?
No answer until now. So, I have to take the precautions by ourselves. Of course, I'm not armed, I have no machine guns, anything like that.
You had anonymous phone calls?
Yes.
What sort of calls?
Saying that they're going to blow my head and things like that.
The Socialist Party is far enough to the left politically to have avoided the violence meted out to the centre parties. Their leader, Mario Soares, was made foreign minister when, like the communist leader Cunhal, he was included in the provisional government set up by the army last May. For all the crowd's acclaim, the man who was idolized on his return from exile in Paris a year ago is in a precarious political position. His party wants unity of the left, but for socialism, not communism. The leadership fears being exploited by the communists, kept in alliance as long as they're useful, discarded if they become a threat.
We know that the Communist Party, who always want to dominate, I don't think it is worth to have the real power, and there will be some other parties, but they are satellized by the Communist Party. We refuse this because we think our people want to live democracy, wants to live the liberties, the main liberties of expression, of information, of strike, etc. And this is very important that we that our people can live these liberties. And we don't think that the Communist Party is interested, is really interested on this.
Are you prepared for trouble?
Yes, we are prepared. Yes, really. We think that we want to be pacific, but we think that it will be very difficult. There will be some troubles till we arrive at the new society.
You have on your desk a list of cars, car yes. numbers. What is that list?
It is a list furnished, I think, by the military authorities to inform the parties that these cars carry some people, some dangerous people, some reactionary people who can kill someone.
You expect to be shot from one of those cars?
We don't expect, but we think it's possible that these people can do something against our party and the other parties, on the left parties.
There are plenty of people on the left who carry guns, though, aren't there?
Yes, there is some groups, Luar and FSP, and some other, carry guns. Yes.
Is this a good thing for democracy?
No, it's a bad thing. We are fighting against this. We want to, and we'll create in the government something to avoid these groups and to forbid these activities. Because if you don't do like this, we can have a dangerous situation for democracy.
The Communist Party shed no tears when on Tuesday evening the Maoist MRPP, an ultra-left trade union party, and a right-wing party were all banned from contesting the election. Banned by the armed forces who the previous day had sworn themselves in as a 24-man oligarchy, the Revolutionary Council.
General Francisco da Costa Gomes, Presidente da República e Chefe do Estado-Maior General das Forças Armadas. Brigadeiro Vasco dos Santos Gonçalves, Primeiro-Ministro. Vice-Almirante.
Familiar faces appeared at the Presidential Palace for the swearing-in ceremony.
Brigadeiro Hotel Nuno Romão Saraiva de Carvalho, Comandante Adjunto do COPCOP. Capitão Tenente Carlos de Almada Contreiras.
Token concessions to dissent within the armed forces movement were made as President Costa Gomes signed new young officers onto the council.
Eu, abaixo assinado, afirmo solenemente pela minha honra que cumprirei com lealdade as funções que me são confiadas.
But at the same time, the MFA took total and undisguised political control of Portugal by dissolving the partly civilian government. As the backslapping proceeded, the civilian politicians looked on with mixed reactions. Alvaro Cunhal, sure of a place in any new civilian government. Mario Soares, anxious at the development, less sure of keeping his ministry. Cunhal welcomed the Revolutionary Council. He sees no contradiction between the promise of democracy and this tightening of political control.
Should the MFA not hand back to the people the power to run their own country the way they want?
Não acha que o MFA deveria devolver ao povo a liberdade para se poderem governar, autogovernarem sem a existência deles?
O MFA pertence ao povo.
The MFA belongs to the people.
Não está, não é contra o povo, é uma emanação do próprio povo.
The MFA is not against the people, they come from the people.
But the people have no say in who represents them on the Revolutionary Council.
Mas o povo não tem qualquer qualquer palavra.
Tem uma grande palavra a dizer, porque no dia em que o nosso povo não queira os militares não ficam.
The Portuguese people has actually a big work to say, because on the day that they don't want the MFA any longer, they just won't have it.
You just said that if people did not want the armed forces movement, it could be removed. How could people do that?
Que o MFA ficava no ar.
The MFA would stay up in the air.
Sem suporte.
Without support.
At the moment, though, the MFA's feet are firmly on the ground. But are they marching Portugal towards communism?
There are so many kinds of communism at this moment in the world. It depends.
Well, would you like it to become a communist state along the lines of Hungary? Or would you like it to become an independent communist state along the lines of Yugoslavia, for instance?
Yes, for instance, why not?
Yugoslavia?
Yes, why not? But it is not a wish. I can express myself as my own opinion.
Yes, what is your own opinion?
Of people.
What is your own opinion in this?
My own opinion at this moment?
Yeah.
Well, I have no opinions. I belong to the movement of the armed forces.
What I want to know is the political color of the army at this moment, of the armed forces movement.
The political color? Well, I would say it is a very socialist, but not exactly the socialist color that is represented by the Socialist Party in Portugal. So, the target would be something like between the Communist Party, the Portuguese Communist Party, and the Socialism, and the Portuguese Socialist Party, not exactly that.
But somewhere between the two?
Yes, somewhere between the two.
Portuguese communists may still be learning the Internationale, but in the last 12 months, they've dominated the country's politics, as they have its streets. The party faithful have no reason to doubt that they and the armed forces movement are marching in step. An enigmatic situation for an important member of an anti-communist alliance, NATO. If the attempted coup was suspect in that it so perfectly suited the aims of the left, its results are not in question, a dramatic lurch to the left. This threatens the free elections promised within a year of the revolution of April the 25th, and the communists celebrate with unashamed arrogance their enormous power in high places. Does the Communist Party not exercise a power out of proportion with its support in the country?
Sim, digamos, a parcela de poder do Partido Comunista é muito inferior à sua influência real.
The part of the communist power in Portugal is very inferior to
influência to their, que nós temos na política nacional.
To the influence that they have on the national politics.
At the moment, they have a very strong influence on national politics.
Têm de momento uma influência muito forte na política nacional.
Se não podemos dizer muito forte, podemos dizer forte.
Cunhal says not very strong, but strong.
What percentage of the vote do you expect the Communist Party to get?
Dr. Cunhal understood and said, I don't know at all.
I know, he understands everything I'm saying.
Não pode haver sondagens de opinião, que sondagens com o mínimo de seriedade nas condições atuais de Portugal, não pode haver.
There is no possibility of making a research of the public opinion for the moment in Portugal.
Vamos a ver.
We'll wait and see.
Well, the left is playing her game. The left, especially the Communist Party, know very well that the elections for them will be negative. All the polls more or less secretly made say that we won't have more 10, 12, 15% maximum. Communist Party and satellite parties. So they are playing their game, but we must play ours and we must fight for elections. And I say again, and not being optimistic but realistic, that when we have the elections, things will be different.
It's about a year since I last interviewed you.
I remember that very well.
You were looking to the future full of enthusiasm and hope for the new democracy which had arrived after 50 years. How do you feel now, 12 months later?
Well, I'm still looking to the future with hope, but it's much more difficult to build a democracy than I expected. That I must agree. When we arrive at the conclusion it's impossible, and it's we are just playing a game and inclusively giving our guarantee, our, how you say that, our guarantee, I think it's the name, to a regime which is not democratic at all anymore and cannot be democratic and has no chance of being, because that's the problem. And I think we'll just abandon them, make a statement and say, okay, we tried, we did our best, we risked, we lost time and energy and lives maybe, but
You would disband your party?
On principle, I think so. This is a very personal opinion. We have not discussed it to that extent, but I think we have many times internally and externally spoken about limits. After those limits are passed, the only possibility, without going into a revolutionary or clandestine action, is to really go home and to stay home, if possible.
The only obstacle in the steady onward march of the communists is a free election that would measure their true support in the country. At midnight last night, the promised election was postponed to the last day possible within the pledge of the armed forces movement. It remains to be seen whether that free election will take place at all.